Hi everyone, welcome to this Video Some Frontier video. My name is Jay Wakefield, and what you're looking at here is what most people might think of in the UK if you were to say the name Gateway. Gateway, for quite a long time, was a supermarket that was kind of one of the smaller ones. They if you're interested, they were taken over by Summerfield's, which in 2010 was actually taken over by the cooperative. However, if you are a computer person and you like older machines, you may think of this when you think about Gateway. Yes, of course, what you are looking at here is the Gateway 2000 40X2-66 or something like that. And it has its characteristic extremely tall case, and well, these machines are awesome. Billy Corr's auntie has one. That was the first computer that Billy Corr ever used. And Gateway were actually quite popular in the 90s, and they made quite a lot of computers both in the US and the UK. However, after they lost the Gateway 2000 moniker and became Gateway, they actually became a lot less interesting. In fact, by the late 90s, they were literally making generic beige box computers. Gateway are still going now, and unfortunately, as Matthew H16 can attest, as he's been currently working on a Gateway, now it is basically just a very, 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 very low rung on Acer's product ladder. They really aren't that good at all. And here we have a fine example of something from Gateway 2000's long and illustrious history. Now, I thought that Gateway 2000 had stopped being called Gateway 2000 somewhere in the mid-90s. However, I was quite surprised to realise that Gateway 2000 were Gateway 2000 right through at least until 1998, when this machine was made. Now, what you are seeing here is not only the laptop computer, oh yes, and the original power supply, I thank you, you are also seeing a travel light module. Dell FedExed such a thing to UXW Bell overnight for his D800. I got this one with the Gateway 2000. Underneath the travel light module, just to put that there, is a floppy disk drive, which is connected. I mean, this is a multi-bay drive, this could go right in the machine, but it's connected via a cable which was also provided to the parallel port on the laptop. Just to the back of the floppy drive, we see a Gateway 2000 telepath card, PC card. Sometimes it's pretty standard to get a modem card with your machine. Not in a cassette case that's, well, not really a cassette case. It's kind of like a cassette case, but it's, instead of being big enough for a cassette, it's big enough for a PC MCIA card. Very nice. With the cow design on it. Moo. And Here you might see a great big pile of CDs. Now, I got all these CDs with this machine. It was really quite something opening the box to this computer, if I'm honest. But let's have a look at what we got. We got a Windows 95 CD. Very nice. Oh dear. And the case seems to have derped. Dearie me. We have a Windows 98 CD. Very nice. Do you know what? I'm going to pull this other table across. I also have a new pair of trousers for me that came this morning. Very nice. Solo System CD. Or is it Solo Estim CD? Or is it... Yeah, I think that's what it is. Solo Estim CD. Oh, no. No, the S there is there in Solo. Yeah, Solo System CD version 2.4. When reinstalling Windows NT 4.0 from the System CD, please refer to the tech note entitled Installing Windows NT 4.0 on your Gateway 2000 Solo Notebook. Lors d'une réinstallation de Windows NT fait partie du système CD, veuillez vous reporter à la note technique intitulée Installation du logiciel NT 4.0 sur le notebook solo de Gateway 2000. And I'm not going to read the other languages. I am also quite aware that these CDs are... This pile of discs is going upside down. My OCD will not withstand. So, put them the other way up. I also have Professor Windows 95, which I'm pretty sure didn't come with this notebook. And I... Certainly sure that the Windows 98 CD didn't either. Here's another Windows 95 CD, this time with an intact case, although the CD is kind of loose in there. So, there we go. Never have too many of those. Microsoft Works 4.0. Registered and up-to-date software for the home. Microsoft... Works 4.5 gives you a word processor, spreadsheet and database. Groovy. It also gives you drawing and communication tools and Microsoft Internet Explorer, all in one intelligent product. Go ahead, communicate, organize, create and explore. It's easy. And this is 4.5, not 4.0. Quicken 6, I'm not sure whether this came with the Gateway 2000 or not, but it's here. Quicken did come bundled with a lot of systems. I certainly know that you could get it for Packard Bells, with Packard Bell systems. And for some reason, I don't know why I know this, but it comes with used to come with some compacts as well. I have no idea how I could know this. And here we have Microsoft Office 97 Small Business Edition. Again... I'm not sure, I'm pretty sure that that would not come standard with this computer. However, if Gateway 2000 were as good with business as Dell are, you could probably spec it. I also have a Windows 95 manual right there for the CD key. And there's all sorts of paperwork for this machine. I really do like this. I got this, same thing with the Compaq actually. Then again, the Compaq. My parents did keep it all. Very good. There's instructions using the touchpad mouse. Specifications. But this isn't... I'll read this sheet, but this is, pretty much specifications for every one of the Gateway 2000. This is a Solo 2300... multimedia notebook. Processor type, Intel Pentium processor at 133 MHz. Mobile Pentium processor With MMX technology. Yeah, that's mobile Pentium processor at 133 MHz. Mobile Pentium processor with MMX technology at 166, 200 and 233 MHz. External cache, 256K or 512K SRAM, pipelined burst L2 cache. Core logic, Intel 430TX, system clock frequency, either 60 or 66 MHz. BIOS is a Phoenix plug-and-play Note BIOS with DMI 2.0 support, 256K flash ROM. System memory, 3 SODIMM sockets expandable to 192 MB. Accepts SDRAM, FPM or EDO modules, 8, 16, 32 and or 64 modules, 1, 2 or 3 modules of these capacity can be installed. Excellent. You could literally have 136 megs of RAM in this if you wanted, and then someone would be like, my, that is an odd amount of RAM there, isn't it? And that someone would be me. LCD panel. LCD panel size 13.3 inches TFT XGA 1024 by 768 color depth, 65,536 colors, 16 bit, 12.1 inch TFT SVGA or 12.1 DSTN SVGA resolution, 800 by 600 color depth, 262,000 colors, 16-bit. Video subsystem, Neo Magic NM2160 high performance, that's debatable, multimedia flat panel CRT GUI accelerator with 2 megs of integrated RAM, interface 32-bit burst mode PCI bus with 128-bit memory interface.
Ooh, 128-bit. That's groovy.
External video supports simultaneous LCD or external monitor variable sync for compatibility with a wide range of monitors. Composite video out supports NTSC and PAL standards. For composite video, connected to standard TV monitors with RCA video input connector. External, my goodness, this goes on for ages. My good friend Billy Carr said, well, when I originally got this machine, he actually turned around and said, Jay, I want a 2-hour video on this system. What he said was, you can have it be a complete rant about David Cameron if you want. Hang on a minute. He likes Gateway 2000, but if I'm ranting about David Cameron in a 2-hour video, I'm not exactly spending time with this machine, am I? Right. And I think the Gateway 2000 is what Billy would want to see, not the rant on David Cameron. Anyway, back to this. You're all going to be experts on Gateway 2000 Solo 2300 notebooks by the end of this video. There is a test on Friday morning. I will be grading you, and it will go towards your final mark. Kidding on. One time I wanted to be a teacher. And all the adverts go, those who can, teach. Those who can't, some of them do anyway. Herp derp. I had good teachers at school, which is why I've got a degree now. My former maths teacher, Mr. Bentley, helped me get grounding in computers. Right. Yep, that's... No, I'm correct. No, that is true. He was brilliant. He was the one who showed me originally how to make how to change a mouse partner size in Windows 95. Anyway, back to this. External monitor, resolution, colour depth, 640 by 480 at 60 million colours, 800 by 600 at 60 million colours, 1024 by 768 at 65,536 colours. Video hardware, Multimedia support, YUV input from the system bus, or video support, YUV RGB conversion capture scaling interpolation. Zoomed video PCMCIA connection to zoomed video port. IO keyboard 19x19mm keys with 3mm travel. Windows 95 keys US, UK, English, German, French, Japan available. International keyboards not available in the US. Pointing device easy pad touchpad. Or if you're in the UK, EZ. That's my good friend Matt Halstead. He's always arguing with me about the correct way to pronounce the letter Z. He thinks that the Spectrum ZX should be pronounced ZX. LGR is willing to meet me halfway on this one. He says, well, he didn't actually say, well, I'm willing to meet you halfway on this. He didn't actually say that. He says that the ZX should be pronounced ZX. So, do you know what? I'm going to go... I'm going to meet the Americans halfway and say that EZ pad should be pronounced easy pad. Now, I must remember to do it on... on Asus EFI motherboards. Because I always go, oh yeah, we need... Well, I'm in EZ mode at the moment. It's also pronounced EZ. As in, easy. As in, that was easy. Okay, where was I? Pointed device, easy pad, touchpad. External ports, 2 USB ports. Very generous, I will say, because even Dell at the time, I mean, Dell would only give you 1 USB port for a while. As much as I regret to say this, Compaq was the same. Yikes. I think Acer were one of the more generous ones. But yeah, Gateway 2000, 2 USB ports, and a system ship with an operating system that did not fully support USB. That is how dedicated they are. FIR serial 165508 compatible, parallel, bidirectional, EPP, ECP, NTSC or PAL video out, PS2 keyboard or mouse, DC input, docking connector, PCMCIA Type 3 or 2, Type 1 or 2 card sockets, line in, line out, headphone out, microphone, VGA external monitor, PCMCIA controller, CL-PD6832 with zoomed video and 32-bit card bus support on the PCI bus. Power, battery, intelligent 60.5 WHR 12 cell ion, lithium ion, R35 watt hour 8 cell nickel metal hydride. Battery life, lion 12 cell depends on application, approximately 4.5 hours. NiMH 8 cell depends on application. Charge time, Li-ion 12 cell 3 hours with the unit off or in suspend, 4 hours with the unit on. NiMH 8 cell 2 hours with the unit off or in suspend, 5 to 8 hours with the unit on. Internal bridge battery maintains memory in suspend mode for about 10 minutes when swapping batteries. Power management, suspend mode lasts for about 1 week with a fully charged battery. APM 1.2 with battery gauge suspend warning on low battery. AC adapter, 19 volt DC, 50 watt output, auto voltage adjustment between 100 and 240 volts. Alternating current, storage, hard disk. Removable, accepts 2.5 inch 12.7mm hard disk drive, 2.1, 3.0 and 4.0 gigabyte capacities. Hard disk controller, 2 independent, has mastering enhanced IDE channels on a PCI bus, supports PIO and Busmaster DMA transfers up to 6 megabytes and Busmaster Ultra DMA transfers up to 33 megabytes. CD-ROM, 7-speed men, 11-speed max, automatically switchable. ID interface, 1500 kilobits a second, kilobytes a second data transfer rate, 10-speed. Full stroke access time, giggity. 320 milliseconds. At 10 speed, 128k data buffer, CD enhanced compatible, modular. Floppy disk removable, parallel port adapter allows external connection, giggity. Sound chipset, Yamaha YM715, 16-bit stereo audio, 20 voice, 4 operator, FM music, synthesis, full duplex, operation with 2 DMA channels, software wavetable synthesis on MMX equipped systems. Volume control, rotary hardware control on the side of the unit. Speakers, Altec Lansing stereo speakers built into the palm rest. Microphone, omnidirectional microphone built into the palm rest. Connectors, microphone, line in, line out, headphone out. Compression, ADPCM, ESPCM, compression available for lower bit rates. MIDI in out available through solo docking station options. Docking station, solo mini docking station, one serial port, IR, one parallel, VGA, AC in, line in, microphone in, headphone, speakers out, PS2 keyboard, PS2 mouse, game MIDI port, one PCM CIA type 3 slot, R2 type 2, cold, warm and hot docking supported, 3 French hens, 2 turtle doves and a partridge in a pear tree. Solo docking station, one serial, one parallel VGA output, AC in, PS2 mouse, PS2 keyboard, game or MIDI port, mic in, mini dim, line out jack, line in jack, one PCM CIA type 3 or 2 type 2, dual, 2 dual ISA PCI slots, very nice, one internal 3.5 inch bay rear, one external 5.25 inch bay front, One gateway solo monitor, option bay monitor stand, cold, warm and hot docking supported. Physical specification, system unit weighs less than 7 pounds with battery and floppy disk drive. AC adapter weight 14.6 ounces or 415 grams. Travelling weight less than 8 pounds with battery, CD-ROM drive and AC adapter. Dimensions 291 millimeters wide by 233, depth by 47.5 millimeters. Environmental temperature, operating temperature 0 to 35 degrees centigrade. Storage temperature -25 to 60 degrees centigrade. Operating humidity 20 to 80%. No condensation. Storage humidity 15 to 98%, no condensation. Vibration operating 5 to 500 hertz, 0.5 g acceleration. One oct min, 15 min dwell at all resource points. Vibration non operating 5 to 500 hertz, PSD 0.015 g. Hertz 2.2, 16 GRMS 200 to 500 Hertz, minus 6 decibels oct on 3 axis, 2 hours axis. Whatever all that means. So that's the specification. Using your Gateway 2000 solo media notebook, I'm not going to read through all this, but suffice it to say, some nice coloured diagrams in here. I just want to see what wallpaper they're using, actually. Oh, look, there's the bottom of the laptop. How clever. Oh, look. I want that as a wallpaper. I'm going to use a power adapter. Gateway solo, blah, blah, blah. CD player. Awesome Windows 95 screenshots. Would you look at that? Does my system look like that? No, it doesn't, because it's running Windows 98 at the moment for some reason. That must be what the docking stations look like. Yeah. And maintaining and troubleshooting your notebook. I wonder if this is a... a service manual. I highly doubt it because I'm not sure Gateway would want folk servicing the machines, because then that will lose out on revenue for charging over the odds for fixing a computer. And then finally we get to the machine itself. So let me take you on a wee guided tour of this machine here. On the front, you do have, like Gateway said, you do have the multi-bay. I got this machine, I can't remember whether it was July or August. However, the CD-ROM drive that came with mine wasn't working too well, and I couldn't run Windows 95 too well with it. Because I couldn't get it to play ball with the PCMCIA CD-ROM drive that I was using, and Windows 98... really not the right system for this. However, there is the Gateway 2000 Solo emblem on top of this machine. Doesn't use the Golden G, does this one. But this logo always makes my OCD a wee bit. Because that yellow square is... well, it's off, isn't it? It should be there, but it's not, it's there! But a new CD-ROM drive arrived just this morning, along with the trousers, and it fits. These things must be rare as gold dust, because I had to actually order my CD-ROM drive. It came from Ohio. It came from, and it was, it's quite good because it actually tracked, the eBay tracking progress bar actually worked for this one. I tracked it through... I had a look last night. It was had been from Defiance in Ohio to Detroit, Michigan... Michigan. To... somewhere... and then it arrived in Great Britain on the 26th. Today is the 28th. And I have the drive. Then there is also the battery. Now the battery, I have tested this, and when it's fully charged, it will keep this machine going for a couple of hours. Now either this battery has been reconditioned, or it must be a really good battery, because this machine is 15 years old. And somewhere I did get a date code, February the 18th, 1998. Now, I can't tell you what I was doing on the 18th of February 1998, but what I can tell you is what I was doing the week after. I was on a school trip. I was on a school trip with someone from the Philharmonic Orchestra, and we sung lots of songs about Earth. And then a year later, we were on another trip, this time in Glasgow, with the same person, and girls from the local school, and we were singing a musical version of The Owl and the Pussycat. Now, anyway, this is not about The Owl, the Pussycat, and their inability to go seafaring. This is about this here laptop. Now, I'm not sure how to... I'm not sure where the switch is to unhook this... oh, here we go. I think I've got it. There we go. I want to see what battery's on here. Yep, it's a lithium-ion battery. Oh, come on. I should have known that wasn't going to be an NIMH with this much longevity in it. But after I saw that the battery was that good, I knew I had to give this machine a really good shot. So, on the front, there's the multi-bay. On the right side, there is the battery, and then you have the hard disk slot, and I don't think Gateway were joking when they said it's removable. How removable do you want a hard disk to be? Nice. Now, I'm not entirely sure. It's been a while, so please forgive me. I'm not entirely sure what size this is. Could be 2 or 3 gigs. I really couldn't tell you. Then there's 2 USB ports and the power in, DC in. Now, testament to how well this machine's been taken care of, how good a condition it's in, and a slight testament as well to Gateway 2000's excellent design. Well, here you have the Kensington lock slot, pretty standard feature, but here is the port door. Nice. And it's still quite tight. Actually clips on, doesn't just flap around. Now, with the port door in place, all you see is the infrared port and the PS2 mouse and keyboard port. However, if you open the port door, it will actually clip on underneath the laptop, tucked away, out of harm's way. And with that open, you reveal IEEE 1284 parallel port, the docking station port, VGA out, serial port, and then on the other side we have composite out and the PC card slots, one type 3 or 2 type 2, and there is also let me have a look. Microphone, line in, line out, headphone, and the physical volume control that Gateway themselves were talking about. Now what I'm going to do is I'm going to connect up this drive, and we're going to switch the machine on, and we're going to get straight stuck in with the installation of Windows 95. Sorry, I had to cut the video there because, I needed to connect up the parallel port. I needed to connect the floppy drive to the parallel port. And if I'm going to be completely honest, this is not the easiest machine to give a reach around to. Inappropriate! Anyway, a couple of things I want to say about this machine before we continue. This machine has a 200 megahertz Pentium MMX processor. Now that I know for sure, which makes this machine awesome. And I'm no stranger to awesome machines built in 1998 that have 200 megahertz processors. So here I've made a Gateway 2000 Solo 2300 boot disk. I'm going to load it in now. I'm going to see what happens. Will it make a Gateway factory install? I don't know. But it's going to start Windows 95. Because that is something that's like really, really good. Oh, something's happening. It's exciting, this. The screens went all grey. Press the F1 key for the English language. Press F1 for confirmation. Welcome to Gateway 2000's Universal Boot Disk Setup. Please take your time to read the information presented to you during the setup carefully. I guess that means don't read it in a stupid accent or something. First, a word about how to navigate through this information. A green down arrow symbol in the lower right corner of this window means that there is more information available. You can access this by... And you're finished. You're about to detect your keyboard. It's the English UK keyboard. Oh yeah, I totally read all that. The program will now attempt to auto-detect your hardware. When you continue, the program will start auto-detecting the following hardware. CD-ROMs, SCSI cards, plug-and-play sound cards. If no CD-ROM has been detected, you have to select a CD-ROM manually from a list of CD-ROMs. So I want to the setup procedure is complete. The system will reboot in order to finalize these settings. When your system has been rebooted, you'll enter the Universal Boot Disk main menu. Well, that's a first. I've never had to actually set up a boot disk before with all the hardware. I really haven't. That's something. I must admit, that really is quite something. Do you know what I'm going to do? I'm actually going to go through setup and just load in the default values. And that. Yes. There we go. See, I'm hoping that this boot disk is going to be some sort of restore. Activate some sort of restore mechanism. In which everything will be nice and neatly installed. In a nice and neat way. However, I really don't know what this will do. So it's detected the CD-ROM drive. MSC CDX version 2.25. Your boot disk is not write protected. Please write protect your disk. No, blah, blah, blah. Okay, so I'm going to have to write protect this disk. I'll need to make sure I get a permanent boot disk. That could have gone better. Oh, wow! So, I can install an operating system. So I don't know what happens here. You just literally install operating system. Unless this is just a friendly boot disk. Okay, so I deleted all the partitions on this hard drive and went back to the OS installation screen, and what's happened is boot floppy has actually taken it upon itself to format and partition the hard disk. It's done it as a lot of disks were done back in the day, I believe in FAT16 partitions, because it's formatted 2 gigabyte partition, and it created another 1 gigabyte partition, I do believe. Now it's preparing the OS installation on the hard drive. So I don't know what's going to happen here, whether it will do my usual, well, whether it'll do my trick of copying everything to the cabs folder. So I think what this looks like is just a regular Windows 95 install. Quite a clever idea though, to have a boot disk that, you know, takes care of everything and does it in a menu-based interface. I'd do quite like that. Anyway, I will get back to you once this is done. So the Windows 95 install on this system is just a kind of standard fare, just run-through setup. It's, apart from the way that I got to setup, once I was in setup, it was just exactly the same as in any Windows 95 setup. I mean, that I could have, you know, loaded myself up from the CD. You know, things like that. Now, I found this boot disk utility on the Gateway Solo disk. I've got to be honest, I had installed Windows 95 manually on this before, but I was having certain issues with the PC card slots, and before I'd got the CD-ROM drive, you know, I'd used my PC card CD-ROM drive to actually install Windows 98 Second Edition. Didn't seem to be having any issues with them, but I don't really want Windows 98 on this machine, if I'm honest. You know, I see this as a Windows 95 machine. I mean, this machine was built before Windows 98 even came out, and the fact that it has drivers for Windows 95 and 98... Well, 95 NT for it. And yes, it does have drivers for Windows 3.1, so I'm going to have to test that out at some point. It does not have drivers for Windows 98. Which, again, leads me to believe it's more a Windows 95 laptop. Now, don't get me wrong. 200 MHz and 32 megs of RAM is enough. In fact, it's more than enough to run Windows 98. Okay, for Windows 98, you might want to bump up the RAM, and certainly not a problem getting, you know, memory modules in there. There's three slots, and only one of them is populated. But certainly, I mean, you know, this could run Windows 98 very comfortably. Thing is, like I said, you know, I want it as a 95 machine. I really do. It is quite quick at installing Windows 95. It'll be interesting to see where it put the Windows files. Listen at that hard disk going. Sounds like an old motorcycle on a cold winter morning. Actually, no, it doesn't. Sounds like a 25-year-old transit van on a cold winter morning. Right. Okay, so that's Windows 95 setup finished. Asking me to remove the boot disk. And then just kind of click OK. So it has done something with setup. It's installed the... it has done something on the C drive. It's installed the MS-DOS CD-ROM drivers, which is kind of nice. Getting ready to run Windows 95 for the first time. Oh, it's exciting to see that screen. Excellent. So I've selected my time zone, configuring Windows messaging. No, I don't want to be doing that. Once upon a time, maybe I probably would have used it. In fact, I definitely would have used it. So it'll be quite interesting to see now what happens. So, pretty much looks like standard fare. Except I have two partitions. And they are FAT. F-A-T, not FAT32. Right. That's just fantastic. Thanks. Thanks, Gateway. Yeah, really appreciate that. That's really nice. Yeah. Converting them to FAT32 will be quite easy. However, it's a lot easier in Windows 98, I'll give it that. So what I've just done now is installed the USB device driver, the USB support for Windows 95, because of those two beauties on the right-hand side of this machine. Well, using the boot disk certainly seemed to have one desired effect. My beautiful PC card slots. However, PCI Universal Serial Bus, that's not been really detected. However, I can go ahead now and use the Gateway 2000 disk to actually go ahead and install all of the drivers. So, I've had a practice run at this, obviously. And now I can actually show you how to do it in a good way. First off, we're going to go ahead and install the video card drivers. Now what this will do is, this will restart the computer once, and then it will set up the video card driver. And then it'll restart again. So like that. It's going to build the driver information database, because I think driver information databases are better when they've been built rather than, you know, if someone breaks them down or something, I don't know, like, ask your local estate agent, I don't know, getting on, tired humour is not good humour. And I really am quite tired. I mean, sleeping pattern's completely messed up thanks to my depression. And yeah. I'll tell you something. I'm glad I got the CD-ROM drive for this machine today and was able to get it out and, you know, give it a good go. Because really, today I was just feeling absolutely terrible. Now, before I'm ready to actually continue on with the driver install, what I want to do is set the screen resolution. I'm going to set it to 1024 by 768. I'll set the screen resolution first. It's a laptop display panel. It's the XGA version. Nice. And then I will go and set the colour depth. And because of this video card, it's 16-bit colour only at 1024x768 resolution. And you know what? That is fine by me. I am perfectly fine running this at 16-bit colour at 1024x768, given the age of the machine. Do you know what I mean? If I really want 32-bit colour, yeah. Anyway, this is very tiny screen, so I'm going to need to... reset the font size. And I'm going to change the icon spacing. So then icons and text won't be overlapping, although I think I might need to give it a wee bit more. Do you know what? I'll go for my usual setting of 54. We don't need online services. Thanks. And now let's go back to the software CD, click on driver configuration. Now we're going to install the sound card. And I've got to tell you, this sound card is a wee bit of a tasty tarty, so it is. This is a Yamaha sound card, and this and the Altec Lansing speakers, they go a lot louder than you'd expect. So that's the sound drivers being installed. I do have one gripe with this CD, though, and I will tell you it in a wee minty when I come to install some of the other drivers. But first, I want to install the Yamaha XG software, because... Yay, Yamaha! Yep, that works. Even if it is a wee bit quiet. Windows 95 Microsoft Internet Explorer. I wonder if I open this in Animation Shop, whether it'll actually support the animated bar at the bottom. Because what I should do is I should change that to read Microsoft Windows 95 Mozilla Firefox. On any modern version of Windows, that would be true. Microsoft Internet Explorer. Seriously. So now, I believe, now that the sound card's installed, I believe it is time for a canyon test. So that's what I'm going to do. So I'm going to go to C, Windows, Media. I'm going to add canyon. I'm going to skip right to the end. And I love how this looks like a hi-fi. Listen at that, this is amazing. Really good sound. Oh great, now I've got to... And that sounds amazing. Okay, so now the time is much, much later. In fact, it's now the 29th of September. The time is currently 26 minutes to 2, 1:34 a.m. I've done my stint on the All-Star show. It was very, very good. UXW Bill was there. And the whole thing was just amazing. Now it's Randy's turn, and that's probably what you can hear in the background. Anyway, I'm going to explore a couple more things that you can do with this boot disk, which I'm going to do, including making MS-DOS shortcuts for Windows 9X. I wonder if this is a case of having real DOS mode, like on the compact machines. Oh yeah, I forget, you've got to hit the F1 key to continue. Install CD-ROM drivers, display boot disk settings, reset boot disk settings, go to other options. Remove all CD-ROM drivers, remove all MS-DOS shortcuts in Windows 95, exit without loading keyboard drivers. Oh no, that's install MS-DOS shortcuts to Windows 95. When you continue, an MS-DOS shortcut will automatically be installed on the Windows 95 desktop. The shortcut's name is, what is that? VBX, where X can be between 0 and 9. Principle used here is that manually removing a line from the configuration is easier than manually adding a line to a configuration. This option installs references to HiMem, XMS, EMS, mouse, CD-ROM, sound card, and keyboard. You should remove what you don't need for that particular shortcut. The drivers for the mouse and sound card must be present on your hard disk. If not, you'll be notified that these drivers could not be found. Follow the instructions presented to you at that point. Well, the sound card drivers were installed, so... damn it. Press F1 or F10 to... If you're not running the universal boot program from within Windows 95. Start Windows 95. In Windows 95, you'll notice that an MS-DOS shortcut has been added to the desktop. Go to the properties of the shortcut and remove what you don't need. Dep. Nakamichi is a good mate, Randy. Hang on, Nakamichi. There we go. Excellent. So, what I think I'll do is I'll delete the shortcut and I'll try once again once I've installed the proper mesh drivers. So I've just installed the touchpad driver. Now to install, it's quite funny how the fast IR always goes to this. I don't know why. I'm going to install the Laplink software anyway because it came with the machine. You never know. One day it might actually come in useful. Oh look, there's a page on reinstalling Windows 95. Look at that. I love how they always kind of show you these screens. The For Dummy series did it as well, with the Windows 95 interface, whereas Setup actually starts with the Windows 3.1 style interface. No, that's not right. It's NeoMagic. So this gives you a full guide of how to do this, how to reinstall Windows. Even down to installing your own printer. That was fantastic. What printer? HP LaserJet 5P. Probably not a bad printer. LaserJet 4 was alright, but... yeah, 13 paper jam. Anyway, now to install the other drivers. This is what I had to tell you about. Some of the drivers, you actually have to install them manually. For example, the USB driver, I'm going to have to install that manually. That's not going to be a problem, though. All I have to do... is do this. Although, it seems that the Gateway 2000 way of installing things has actually made my Windows a lot tidier. And for that, I'm really quite thankful. I don't have to go and install the PC, the system devices manually. Probably why. Everything works. So, as well as it does. There we go. That's USB installed. Now to install the actual infrared driver, I'll have to go into the disk manually to do this. And this is part of the problem with Windows 95's non-active desktop update. Look at the mess I'm causing. I mean, I know that I could actually just say, well, look, I'll have it display all in the one window. And actually, that's what I think I will do. Now to install Microsoft Infrared setup. It will actually take me through installing the infrared drivers, which is kind of nice. Yes, it seems that Randy very much likes Billy Joel. I like that, how you've, always seems to find... Oh, the cabs file is in the, hard drive. Oh, yeah, that's good. That's very good. I hope this doesn't upset the, I really do hope that this does not upset the, system. The, PC cards. I'm gonna use the default settings, I think. Yep, that's absolutely fine. I'm just gonna... click finish, and now this will just go ahead and install everything needed for infrared. What? Oh, why has it done that? Why has it gone into auto lock? Didn't want that. There we go. Saying it's needing to restart the PC. That's absolutely fine. Okay, so let's... we now have an infrared icon on the taskbar, which is very nice. And it seems that the machine has kept time. Let's have a look. Hopefully, yep. Still have the PC card sockets. Excellent. Right, I wonder... I wonder if any gateway wallpapers were installed, or whether I have to install those manually. I'm not seeing any so far. I'd have to install those manually. Which is not a problem, actually. There's quite a lot of different gateway wallpapers for this machine. That hard drive. It really is hampering performance on this machine quite a bit. I think this machine would perform a lot better if the hard drive actually worked properly. Like I said, I will probably replace it soon. So I can go to MISC here in this I can do the Windows 95. I can install all the Windows 95 files to the CAB directory. There's network drivers here. And then here's a gallery of desktop wallpapers. Basically what I'm going to do, I'm just right click, copy. Gonna copy it, I think, to the Windows directory. Oh yeah. Bit of Led Zeppelin while I'm working on this here machine. There we go. All now in the one window. And just to make it a wee bit more bearable, I has Ein toolbar. And now, what I can do is I can go to the back to the desktop properties, and as you can see, I've got lots of different gateway wallpapers. Some of them are extremely fantastic. But I'm not seeing the one I saw in the manual. I quite like this one. Whoops. Yes, very nice wallpaper. I quite like that, actually. It's now time for me to install some good stuff. Here's a copy of Works 4.5. Let's throw the CD on the floor. Yes, that's what we're gonna do. Yeah, throw the CD. Yes. Let's try something else! Hopefully without scratching the disc up. I don't know. This disc might work better if it's in the drive. Let's push it in.
Inappropriate!
Oh yeah. Microsoft Works 4.5. Let's put a key in, shall we? Alright, so here we are. We've got all the applications installed. So that's pretty good. It's bit of a tight squeeze around here, and it's a wee bit awkward. But first, we're going to try something that I do quite like. Here is Knowledge Adventures 3D Body Adventure, and as such, it actually runs under MS-DOS. There's not enough memory to start the program. Really? See, this is what can happen when you don't have a proper DOS environment. This was set up by Packard Bell. What on earth are you doing? All right, so here we go. Let's try that again. So I think what I'm gonna need to do is I'm going to need to go into the DOS properties here. Please excuse me, I will have to look close at it. Oh. Where does it point to? Oh well, never mind that. However, I can show you a DOS game that does actually work on this system. Gateway 2000 does have a DOS mode, but you have to install it from the boot disk, and it spends ages grinding at the hard disk, and then it tells you, hey, we can't actually do this. Which is really of no help to anyone. However, I know something that runs, and it runs within Windows, but it runs a wee bit French. Network Q Rally, and this makes excellent use of video here as well. Something that, you know, you don't often get to see in DOS games. How 90s is that? An old Renault Clio there. Ford. I don't know what that is. Crevins, that's an upside down car is what that is. Golf. He got a hole in one! Ford Escort Cosworth. Network Q Rally Championship. I like that in the main menu. It's like, hey, I'm driving a car! Yeah, so as you can see, it's, yeah. It's a wee bit in French. I tried selecting Britannique, but no. Hang on, let's have a look at what rally stages there are. I'm sorry, but I'm not going to be customizing my car in French. Why is it not letting me do anything? Let's try this. Let's try again. Oh, look, I've got an idea. He looks like he's in a van. So it's quite odd. It's use the apostrophe key to accelerate. Not this again. I don't want to go back. I didn't do that time. The car's on fire. So I know what the I'm gonna be lapped! I've been lapped by the Ford Escort! Right, that went well. Now we're both on our roof. Yeah, that didn't go so well. And he's still on his roof. Right. Just my Subaru Australian. Okay, now I know the key to actually accelerate. Why don't we try this? That might be a good idea. I also know how to get in gear now. That's always something that's good. That wasn't supposed to happen. Checkpoint! Wow, just wow. I crashed into someone. I went and then come on. And No. There we go. So that is Network Q Rally, and I must admit, very fun game, although I can't play it. But I also have the usual standard fare, Office 97. And then there's Publisher 98. Let's go ahead. Let's make a newsletter. Yep, that's fine. Okay, let's see. Where are my newsletters? I can't actually see. Damn it. Oh, it's the top one. Newsletter. Let's make something. Let's use this one. Tell you, never do a full install of Publisher 98. You'll be sat there forever. And then I can use a wizard here, which is now on the left. I can change the colour scheme. Very nice. The paperclip has turned itself into a wind chime. Hang on, sorry. So I can have like three columns. No, four columns, okay. No, three columns and a sidebar. Hang on. Would you like a placeholder for customer's address? No, I don't. Publisher will modify. Alright. So the newsletter title. So it's and I can use F9 there to zoom in. Ah, yeah. Thing is, the blooming title's now too big for the actual bar, so maybe I should call it something else. The computer stuff. Oh yeah. There we go, that's completely professional. Herp derp in Whitehall. And I can save it as unfinished newsletter. And then we also have Quicken, that came with the machine, because I don't know why. Yeah, that sound. And we also have something a wee bit different on here. Yes, that's right, I installed Lotus on it. I had this installed on my 2001 custom build. Let's use the font Arial. I kind of like how the formatting toolbar is at the bottom. It's different. Oh yeah, plus Lotus likes to completely forget all the formatting you've just done. Thanks, Lotus. That was... Oh yeah, and it doesn't seem to do the... What?! And with this, you can actually choose from a variety of different colours, more than you can in Office 97. I mean, Office 2000 will let you choose multiple colours and will even let you customise the colours to your. But Office 97 does not actually support that. It only supports like the 16 colour 16. VGA colours, whereas look what I'm doing here, I'm able to like choose, pretty much anything. Well, I say that, there's a few colours that I'm having some difficulty choosing. Yeah, what happened when I wanted to go for mint green? There we go. And, yeah. I'll save that. And I have the active desktop update on here, which means yay, Internet Explorer style thing. What on earth is that? I don't know what that is. There's a WordPro document in here, and there's a publisher file as well. But yeah, so now that I'm using a Gateway 2000, I thought that I should play the first computer game Billy ever played, because the first computer game Billy ever played was on the first computer Billy Carr ever used, a Gateway 2000. So I thought I would play this game as well. You've seen it before on Billy's channel. But I thought I'd give it a wee shot. Oh wow, you can make a boot disk to run it on. Whoops. I don't know why that's not working. I'll just make that. It was working fine a minute ago. Alright, yeah. Some sort of a mark on it. Derp. Oh well. Oh, what? Oh, wow. Pure excitingness. I think what I'm going to do is I should have done this earlier, actually. I'm going to adjust the screen resolution as well, so I can actually see what I'm doing. That theme tune. Can't get rid of the start menu and taskbar from this. Let's try launching it again. Just like properly this time. There we go. Okay, any reason why that's happening? Oh, I've gone on to credits.
Use the mouse to click on the child of your choice.
Okay, so basically, what I'm doing here, for those of you who've seen Billy's video, you'll know that in this game, Mother Goose kind of
goes into the child's bedroom and kidnaps the child. So basically what you are being here, if you click anywhere on the screen apart from on the cancel button, you are an accessory to kidnap. Now think about that next time you play a kid's game. Of course, it's marketed towards kids because nobody would convict a child of kidnap. Quite clever, really. Right, let's have a look. I think I'll be this guy because I kind of look... I used to be a wee blonde. Let me type my name. I don't know. Yeah, I literally was, yeah. I'm gonna click on Mother Goose to play. Are you gonna let me play? Oh, yep, it's loading. There we go. And as usual, standard... usual standard 90s fare, you can basically just click around. Well done. Play ball! Oh, I think I've clicked on the book to make the game begin.
It's time to go to sleep now.
Okay. What? Sorry, you said it was time to go to sleep. Sorry, I just... What? You're dreaming you're a duck. In dreamland. Kind of looks quite stormy. Oh, yeah, well, yeah.
Hello, I'm Mother Goose. I'm so glad you came. My nursery rhymes are all mixed up. Can you help me fix them?
Well, not really, considering you woke me up. You dragged me on a duck. And basically, you brought me here against my wishes. Really? Some old... Haridan is going to say, can you help me find my nursery rhymes? Because I'm too stupid to put them on a floppy disk.
What do you want me to do, Mother Goose? Each of my characters has lost an item he or she needs to complete their rhyme. Without these items, they don't know what to do. They need you to help find them. Can you do this?
Sure I can.
Good. If you need any help, you can find me in my house. Good luck.
Do you know what? Lamberiani sounds fine right about now. Maybe I'll go and help Mary find her little lamb and then we can make some delicious chow. Yeah. Oh, wait. That's not what we're supposed to say right now. So basically like a point-and-click adventure. I could turn the music off. Or down. Do you know what? I might just turn the music down a wee bit. Oh, nice. MG. Yeah. Great. I'm gonna find a broken down British sports car in here. That's a nice fountain. Oh, there's pegs or something. I don't know what I'm looking at. There are flowers. I really can't see properly. This is a trouble. And I've got my phone on a tripod. Well, it's just better anyway, but still. What's inside that barn? I love how they're just kind of sat down, just kind of waiting to eat, like the supper's going to magically appear. Right, what do I do? So I'm supposed to find a ham. Well, I could close out of here. And if this was connected to the internet, I could go to Asda.com or Tesco.com. I actually prefer to go to Tesco.com or order up some ham, but how would I get said ham inside the computer? This is a gateway, but it's not a gateway for ham. Maybe I could order some... Maybe if the Gateway supermarket was still going, I could maybe buy a ham from Gateways. Way! However, Gateway got taken over by Summerfield, and then Summerfield... Oh, wait, hang on, I've just passed something. What's this? Okay, you can't maybe click on that. Oh well. I found some... Well, maybe have some eggs instead.
Hi, who are you two? I'm Jack.
I'm Jill. And we need to climb the hill for water.
But we're missing something.
We lost our pail.
Can you help us?
I'll try and find your pail.
Oh, thank you so much.
Jack and Jill? Oh, no. Well, this wee lad is not like me at 5 years old when I had a head full of yellow hair. Seriously, I mean... I could not read people's thoughts. I still can't. And I've got sheep following me. I'm like the Pied Piper of Wales or something. I don't know. Who's this? You're looking... Well, I sure do like to eat pumpkin. Oh, I've left the sheep behind? What is this? I'm just clicking now and I'm going to all sorts of different places. What is this? Maybe if I... What? It's... So there's a map of where I need to be. So I'm at the castle. So I need to go to the pumpkin. I suppose if I can get... Alright, come on, yellow. Time to move it up. Okay, yeah, I do leave stuff behind. I like how the fountain is kind of a focal point for everything as well. I'll take this woman back to her pumpkin and we'll... Yeah. There we go, I've taken you back to your pumpkin, Danu. Why, thank you ever so kindly, kind sir. I felt awful bad, because I was lost. Okay, I've got you to the pumpkin, now what? Or is that not the right pumpkin? What? Oh wait, that is the pumpkin! For you, Dan! Oh, you dafty. What have I been given? A golden egg? Now the problem, kind sir, I'll tell you what. So basically like all of Mother Goose's nursery rhymes. It's a pretty good game actually, I must say. I must admit, I do quite like it, and if I'd have been able to play this, she kidnapped you too!
Oh, where can he be? Have you lost something? My dog, my little dog. I'll help you look for him. Oh, would you? His ears are cut short and his tail is cut long, and he answers to the name of Spot.
Oh dear. I found a pail of water! Aw, yeah. Well, I found a pail for water. Not of water, it's Jack and Jill. Yeah, we all know they're not going up the hill to fetch a pail of water, Ken. Okay, right enough. See, now, if this game was available on the iPad, it would be absolutely brilliant. You know, I really do like the idea of, you know, kids nowadays being able to get this on an iPad. So, I'll certainly have a look for it, because I know that an autism group I'm a member of, some of the autism parents...
Aren't you forgetting something? I don't think so. horse you can ride, silly. Doesn't everyone know that? Okay, if you say so. But why do I need one? Why'd you see a fine lady upon a white horse? Well, I'll see if I can find one.
I really do like the music to this game. Billy did say it would be good music.
Great, I have mail.
Since when was Jack and Jill at Samba? That was unfortunate. Have you had an accident at work that was not your fault? Call now on... you could possibly claim on the insurance. Call now on Waste of Time Lawyers Compensation. That's 0800 Waste of Time. When you stop, your game will be saved. Aw, yeah. Excellent. That was actually a good lot of fun. So, if you've got any kids and you have an old computer, Sierra's Mixed Up Mother Goose. Actually, not a bad game. It's specially played on a gateway. This is the first time I've ever played this game. And like Billy, the first shottie of it that I've had is on a Gateway 2000. So would you look at that? Anyway, that concludes this video of the Gateway 2000 laptop, the, whatever it is, the Gateway 2000 Solo 2300, 200 MHz Pentium MMX, 32 megs of RAM, and now a 12 gigabyte hard drive, actually. I did have to reformat it, because I did have to put a new hard drive in it, because the one that was in there is just impinging a lot on the reliability of the machine. Anyway, thank you for watching this video. I hope you enjoyed it. If you did like what you see, please feel free to subscribe. The URL to my channel will be following shortly. While you're there, if you've not already done so, please feel free to watch some of my other videos. And whatever you do, I hope you'll join me for my next video. Thank you. Thank you for watching, and I will see you all again.